Good evening. Bailiffs thrusting writs into the hands of trade union officials look like becoming a feature of the industrial scene. But the fine of £200,000 imposed on the Mine Workers Union was brought under old laws, used now in a climate where unions are in direct confrontation with the courts because of new laws. Next week, the Transport and General, Britain's biggest union, will debate the consequences of not paying the £200,000 fine imposed on them for ignoring a High Court order. And it's the new Conservative laws that may have changed the whole face of industrial relations. Whether this use of these new laws and the invoking of old ones is changing industrial relations for the better or worse is what I want to discuss with the politicians tonight. We have tonight Mr. David Penn Halligan, the Liberal spokesman. We have Mr. John Prescott, Labour frontbench spokesman on employment. And Mr. Vivian Bendall, vice chairman of the Conservative Backbenchers Committee on Employment. Mr. Prescott, do you think that the trade unions are in fact divided on this? Some trade unions appear to want to take government money for ballots.
Well, there are different views, but I'd like to give a comment on the presentation. I think the three Secretary of States of Department of Employment have changed the priority of the Department of Employment from that normally of being concerned about jobs, and they've seen unemployment go up three times the level, and they've concentrated on trade union legislation. But trade union legislation, not to get a balance and conciliation, which has been generally the role of the Department of Employment, it's been largely to savage and attack the trade unions and indeed to strengthen the employers' hands. And I think if we look at the results since then, we've probably got the longest strike we've had for decades, more violence than we've ever seen. Unofficial strikes now growing out of the motor car industry, something we thought we'd gone with in the 60s. And it is interesting to compare the way Jaguar dealt with its industrial relations without going to the court, and Austin Rover. And I think David Basnett was probably right there. The industrial relations will be soured in the Leyland situation, and in Jaguar they're likely to go on to be much more effective by not using the courts. And therefore, I think there have been considerable changes, and as David Basnett has said again, all the laws haven't yet been implemented, and I think we're in for some very stormy times.
Now, that's advice to employers. What's your advice to the trade unions, who appear to be divided?
The advice to the trade unions is, as David Basnett has said, is to see, let's see what the effects of the laws are going to be, and they're going to consider them in all their implications in a conference that he says he's calling for. We have to wait and see the full effects of this, but already the signs are very bad.
Mr. Penn Halligan, do you think that the trade unions should adhere to the law?
Oh, of course they should do. So your question, though, you're asking two different questions, I think. One is, what's the effect, and have we a new climate? I'm not certain that one necessarily leads to the other. What's the effect? I think it's too early to tell. Clearly the British Leyland incident is very interesting, but extrapolating from what that one incident into ad infinitum, which I know is the sort of thing politicians do, but I think is perhaps a little foolish this early in the day. As for the general climate, no, I don't think there's been any real improvement. Certainly the battlegrounds have been redrawn a little. I think the government have certainly done some things, and we've supported some of this legislation, but I think it's all stick and no carrot. I would like to have seen far more effort made on profit sharing, on setting up better negotiating procedure, getting management and unions far more together. And I think if they'd been doing both at the same time, then they might have not just had some effect, which I think they have had, they might have actually improved the climate as well. And of course, you have got this background, which is, you know, quite dramatic, of 3 million, well, 4 million, let's not argue about the odd million, unemployed. And a lot of people in companies, they can read their own balance sheets and they can see that a lot of their jobs are pretty dodgy, to put it mildly, and I think that may have had as much effect as the legislation.
Well, in the motor industry, the point was made at the time when the Jaguar strike began and when Austin Rover's troubles began, that the moment the industry appeared to be turning round, the unions wanted more trouble.
Oh, I think the motor industry is just awful. And if there's anywhere where I believe things like profit sharing, whereby those that work for a company can see that the success of their mutual enterprise with those who provide the capital, they provide the labour, the success of that mutual enterprise is to their mutual benefit. Until we can get that sense of feeling into Jaguar, into British Leyland, then I believe basically the saga of the last 15 years will go through cycles. Sometimes it'll be worse than the others, but I fear that cycle will go on and on. And I do not believe this legislation will in fact change the feeling. It might occasionally make management win more often than they did before, but I don't think it'll really change the sense and the feel that exists within engineering, which is of course my background.
I think I firmly believe that as time goes on, there should be profit sharing. But we've got to start off from a stable base. And unfortunately, over the years now, we haven't had a stable base for any length of time. If only we can get a stable base for a period of time, then I believe we can move on to profit sharing, and indeed should move on to profit sharing, and all the things that David is talking about.
But is this a stable base?
Yes.
I think we're beginning to get a stable base for the first time. John has talked about a very long strike. I quite agree, the miners' strike has been a very long strike. But generally, we've seen over the last year or two far less strikes than we've seen for a very long time.
That's a lot to do with unemployment. I mean, you can go through the history of the last century or so. When there's very high levels of unemployment, you get a lot less industrial activity. Indeed, I think that's one of the purposes of high unemployment, to discipline that, and now the government are talking about reducing wages. But you know, when you talk about the climate, Alistair, what we're really talking about is how people feel the government role is in this, and indeed how the court's roles are in these matters. And the government is seen to be very one-sided. And in fact, when you hear that, I think it was referred to in the introduction, that Mr. King, so unfortunately couldn't be here tonight, that's a kind of quiet revolution in itself, isn't it? But the fact is he isn't. But he made a speech yesterday in which he said this quiet revolution. And what does he mean by that? That employees should have more information. They should be told what they're going on about. There's even a line in his speech, be willing to talk to the employees. My God, these were statutory rights that were to be put in by the Vredelin proposals out of Europe. Which government is the one that's opposed them putting into law? This government. Now, on the one hand, they want statutory powers to unionists, and on the others, they ask employers to perhaps influence the atmosphere a bit more. But the reality is, they've strengthened the employers. The employers have got the bit between the teeth, and what we've got is war developing in the industrial front at a time when we need to get people back to work.
But do you agree with ballots? This is part of the government's policy. Mr. Clive Jenkins, who's been mentioned earlier, he said yes, he does agree with ballots, he does hold them, and he accepts the results. Sometimes they go his way, sometimes they don't. Do you think that trade unions should take money from the government to hold ballots?
Well, first of all, on the ballot principle, my union is the National Union of Seamen. I was a seaman for 10 years and I've been involved in a number of strikes.
Well, you have to hold ballots.
Only one here. Why do we have to hold
them? Because so many of your members are overseas. Well, and I mean, you can't all be brought together.
Yes, but I mean, we don't have to usually have a ballot on the wage negotiations. You can leave it to the executive if you want. A number of bodies do that. But we choose to do it by ballot, and quite a number of unions choose to do it. The question is whether the government needs to make it a requirement, in fact, to have a ballot. And then it's when you get into the problems with the courts, isn't it? It's like the motor car industry thing again. You get a strike, which is the normal hands in the air, and the government say, no, you're now going to do it by a secret postal ballot under their legislation. You then get into situations where people might do it. You get into contempt of court, and we're now facing situations where trade union leaders may go to jail because of a contempt of court, not for something that's written in the legislation. But that's always been the difficulty of dragging law into our situation, that people will go to court not because the legislation says you will go to court for breaking this part, but you go to court for contempt of court. And it's like the costs we and our union have found in fighting a case about the ballot for the miners, that the costs for us are 10 that what we could do is probably have a ballot, but our expense introduction said $500,000 that the miners have found in legal costs against them. They're really fines. It's actually, and the courts are becoming the arm of government in those kind of situations.
Well, I just think they could have avoided it all with one simple ballot, and how much stronger the union's position would have been if only there had been a ballot which clearly indicated that their members, of their own free will, in private, with a little piece of paper indicating their desire, indicated that that was the battle they wanted to fight. And I often think, and I worked in a factory myself before I got elected to Parliament, how much stronger it would be if the union could demonstrate the clear will of their members to management on an argument. I think that when that day arrives, they would in fact win many more arguments with management because the union would demonstrate their members were behind them. Whereas quite often one gets the feeling that there is a little militant faction that are manipulating the system in order to get the object they desire as opposed to represent
their
members.
But the government deny that for the CHQ workers. They just say you can't do that.
But say, Mr. Bendel,
well, you pick one bad example.
In the time of the Heath government, there was a threat of a railway strike, which was put off. And then they had a ballot, and the ballot came down for a strike. Now, What does that do? What does a ballot actually do to improve industrial relations?
My view is that the way it improves industrial relations is the fact that I believe if there is a true grievance and the vast majority believe that that is a grievance, they have the right to demonstrate that grievance by ballot and the right to strike. I think that is quite correct. John has talked about the courts being the weapon of the government, but one's got to remember what action a trade union takes on a major strike affects the everyday lives of every individual in this country and could do. And therefore, as such, I believe it right that those people should ballot democratically and decide whether that is the action within that union they wish to take.
Would you then agree then the ballot for the closed shop, which is in the legislation? If, and indeed, as we've already had, though you make a very high proportion, I don't know how you feel, about 85% of those taking part must agree. None of us here would be elected on such principles, but given that so, 85%, if in fact you get that, as now has happened with one or two of the companies for closed shops, are you then agreed that the individuals who don't want to belong to the union and belong, say, in that 15%, then should I be forced to observe the trade union conditions under closed right?
I think it should be as high as 80%. If you're talking about elections to Parliament, obviously we don't have a situation in this country like Australia. But certainly as far as a person's right, whether they wish to work or not, I think it should be as high as 80%. Yes, I certainly do.
It's not the right to work, it's to whether they belong to a trade union. And the government made great play in closed shops, and their argument against closed shops is you deny the individual the right to belong to the right not to belong to a trade union. I mean, that was the whole balance of the argument at the Heath time. And that's what I don't quite understand about the government's position. In this case now, they're prepared to have a ballot. Is that individual's right not to belong, as to belong, are they equal rights, or is one to be subordinate to the other?
No,
once you accept the subordinate role, then you accept that in trade unions sometimes individuals or minorities have to subordinate their view to the general majority view.
Clearly, if you're going to have a right not to join a union, then there ought to be a right to join a union. But would you, John, actually give somebody the right not to join a trade union in a closed shop situation?
Well, of course, under the legislation, if they don't
get it. Not under the legislation.
No.
Would you give it to them?
I would say that in a negotiation situation where it's important to have members in the union, you're treated by the negotiators to how many you've got in it. The proportion of members in your organisation determine the negotiating rights, and I would say that that's essential. The stronger negotiated you are, the more rights you have, and you all benefit from it directly.
But you would not give the right to somebody not to join a trade union in a closed shop situation?
Labour's trade union legislation has been involved in conscience clauses, if you want. But I mean, I would personally, it does undermine trade union organisation if you get a lot of people not wanting to belong to an organisation. That's one of the realities.
So
of
you are in
he's arguing one half of it, and you're arguing the other. I think there is some logic in taking both together, but there is no particular logic in taking either half of the argument.
Well, I mean, these are the balances in industrial relations. There's very little to do with logic. I mean, that's one of the things about industrial relations. If you say you've worked in a factory, there's not a great deal to do with logic.
Ah.
Because you'd never have a strike, for example, where you could show how much money you're losing. Look at the miners. They'll never recoup that kind of loss of money whenever. It'll take them God knows how long to get to that situation. It's not always about logic. It's about the feeling of justice and the balance of situations. And the law doesn't help in that situation because it is very much tied to the logic of the case.
All right, Mr. Penhaligon, on the question of logic and fair play, do you think that the new Act is right to call for periodic elections of trade union officials?
Yes, absolutely. And I think the weakness in the Act is that some of the most famous and most important and most significant trade union leaders in this country are not, in fact, subject to ballot under this particular Act. For example, I'm sure the great British public would be amazed to discover that Mr. Scargill, under this Act, which makes the individual election of big trade union leaders compulsory, will not be subjected under this particular Act. So I actually believe that all the members in the union should have a right to elect their main executive committee. I supported that part of the bill. There was parts of the bill I didn't support, but I did support that part of the bill, and I think that is reasonable, sensible, and logical.
I mean, Mr. Prescott, Mr. Terry Duffy says that's a very important part of the Act, and he's going with it. Now, if you actually get trade union leaders of his importance, if you get the EEPTU, the electricians going for this, why do you say that other unions should resist this and oppose this, both divide the movement and perhaps deprive their members?
When did I say that?
Well, you were saying you were going along with David Basnett, who thought that the present situation
should
not be...
No, I said David Basnett wanted to call a meeting together of the unions, I thought he said, to discuss this aspect. I didn't say that.
Well, we won't parse...
No, but I didn't.
I thought you expressed agreement with Mr. Basnett.
On the point about the talking about it, I come to a union where we do elect. I'm now voting in the election for the Assistant General Secretaries of my offices.
Good.
My union does, so does the AU. And what Teddy Duffy is saying is we are the most democratic union because we always do have these elections. He also said it means we elect more communists, which is an interesting point he made along the way. But nevertheless, our point about that is that every member in a union can demand that they have those kind of ballots. We changed our legislation 6-7 years ago, before any of this legislation, to bring in more and more elections of officials. You know, when I came into the Seamen's Union, they used to get paid without tax, and members changed it, and we had strikes, in fact, to reorganise the union. We say if you're a member of a union, you have a democratic right to come in and change those situations. What we're at dispute about is whether you have to enforce that law, particularly on trade unions, and only picking out trade unions. I wish they'd bring one in for the chairman of the Tory party and make them elect him instead of doing through a puff of smoke and everything else that they
well,
do
now,
for them.
But Mr. Bendel, I think the point is a worry that if this trade union legislation goes to court after court after court, it is then said that the judgments are given by Tory judges. Does this bring the law into disrepute?
No, I don't think it does, because Tory judges or people accused of being Tory judges are not necessarily Tory judges. We've had various changes and appeals turned over in many directions the other way. No, I don't accept that at all. I think certainly the law has got to be completely exemplary from Parliament, and I'm quite satisfied to my mind it certainly is.
But do you think it's actually going to take place? If you really find trade unions like the Transport in general and like the mine workers digging their heels in, are they not going to go to court, and have we not found Tory governments in the past embarrassed because people were put in prison by courts?
I think that this could happen, but I think by and large there's going to be an awful lot of trade unionists that will be prepared to accept this, because I believe there's a lot of trade unionists that believe that there should be balloting in this way. And I believe there's a lot of trade union members who believe that balloting should be in this way. And I believe, again, it is, again, very much the minorities that are totally against this particular type of situation.
But what is
Gentlemen,
your union?
I'm sorry.
What is your
Thank
union?
You very much. It's plainly an issue that won't be decided by governments anymore, even by politicians. It'll be decided by what the courts do, what the unions do, and what plain union members choose to do. From TVI, good night.